My name is Christian Coupé from University of Copenhagen, Institute of Sports Medicine. Together with my co-chair, Hans Christian Holmgren from Sweden, I would like to welcome everyone to this YIA session on fatigue and cycling. And before I introduce the first speaker, I would like just to give you a few remarks on the format of this session. So it would be that the speaker would have 10 minutes for his presentation, and then there will be 5 minutes of questions. And I will give a 1 minute warning on before he ends up his session. So with that, I would also say we only have 2 presentations, and that's to say when we are done with the last presentation and had the questions, the session will close. So now I would like to present the first speaker, Stijn Menting from the Netherlands. And he will present a work with the title Time for Action, the Impact of Fatigue and the Presence of Opponents on the Perception of Time During a 4 kilometer Cycling Trial. Please, Stijn. Are you with us, Stijn? And I can just briefly say that Stijn had some issues with his computer before, but we have had him for the most of the time. So I think something's going on.
Hello. Hello. Can everyone hear me?
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. We can hear you.
I hope everything goes well during the presentation. Should be good. Okay. Well, thank you very much for the nice introduction. I'd like to talk a little bit today about the impact of fatigue and the presence of opponents on perception of time. So Red Bull introduced a, in my eyes, grueling event of exercise, and that is the Red Bull 300. It's now called the Red Bull 400, which people literally run up a ski slope. And people doing this event and similar high exercise events in general say things like, it hurt all over, my legs hurt, my lungs hurt, and there was no end. The end was not in sight and time seemed to crawl. So if we're doing exercise, somehow our perception of time is changed from what we normally have. So how would this be? Well, we know that in a dangerous situation, when we're scared, our brain gets overloaded by sensory cues, and the sensory awareness and the experiences are more densely packed together. And this gives a distortion of time. Time seems to slow by this densely packing of experiences. During very high intensity exercise, our brain also gets overloaded with sensory cues. And this leads normally to an associative state in which we're overly focused on our pain and discomfort from our body. And if you compare the two girls, you'll see that their facial expressions of being scared, and the other girl is almost at the top of the ski slope, are very similar. So would there also be a distortion of time due to exercise intensity? Well, a study of a couple of years back said, yes, time is more distorted at higher fixed exercise intensity rates. However, running up ski slope at Red Bull 400 or going for a run is not a fixed exercise intensity. It is a self-paced exercise. So we're trying to look a little bit deeper in this connection between exercise intensity and distortion of time. We do this through 3 questions. Does time distortion occur during self-paced exercise? Does time distortion increase as the intensity increases throughout the task? and can providing an opponent cause a distraction, which takes us out of that associative state of focusing on pain and discomfort, and therefore reduce the time distortion. So we invited 21 healthy adults to the lab, and we asked them to do a very simple time perception task. We just started a stopwatch and asked them to say stop after 30 seconds. With this pre-exercise and post-exercise, and we have them a task to read out so that they're not counting out the seconds in their head, which will be a lot of cheating. We also did that during exercise at a 500, 1500, and 2500 meter point. And this was blinded for the participants, so they didn't know it was at the 500 meter point. The exercise was a 4 kilometer cycling trial using a cycling ergometer. And the exercise intensity was measured by the rate of perceived exertion on a scale from 1 to 10 at 1, 2, and 3 kilometers. And we chose 2 out of the 3. So 1 and 2, 2 and 3, or 1 and 3. And this was also blinded for the participants, so they didn't know when we asked rate of perceived exertion. Let the participants come in 4 times. During the first time, they did a normal time trial alone, and they were asked to try to do the 4 kilometers as fast as possible. During the second to fourth trial, they did a repetition of this time trial, a head-to-head trial in which they had 2 avatars, one of their own performance and one as a virtual opponent. And that third trial, their goal was still the same, so just reach the end of the 4 kilometers as fast as possible. And in the third trial, they tried to beat the opponent. These conditions were randomized over the 3 visits, so visits 2 to 4. In this research, we looked at the time distortion during exercise, so pre, during, and post-exercise, as well as the 3 conditions. Looked at an increase of intensity throughout a trial, and the time distortion throughout the trial, so 500, 1500, 2500 meters. So the first question, does time distortion occur during self-paced exercise? If we look at the graph, we can see that during pre-exercise, the participants set stop after 33 seconds on average. And during post-exercise, so 2 minutes after the trial, they did the same. However, during exercise, they set stop at 27.5 seconds. So on this, we know that time is perceived to be slower compared to chronological time during exercise. So does time distortion occur during self-paced exercise? Yes. Like we said, a type of fight or flight response occurs and experiences are more densely packed, giving the perception of time that time's slowed. Interestingly, the distortion of time was neutralized after 2 minutes of rest. And this is interesting. So if we take people out of that associative state, which is focused on pain and discomfort, their time distortion also seems to disappear. So our second question was, does time distortion increase as intensity increases throughout the trial? Well, we can definitely see that exercise intensity increased throughout the trial, as you can see in the first day here above. However, we don't see a difference in time distortion throughout the trial. We need to go down a little bit, but no, not statistically significant. So, why is this? Well, there was quite a high variation between participants, so that study was a little underpowered. However, we think it might have something to do that we asked people to record an absolute time, 30 seconds, that was not linked to the exercise outcome. And we know from literature that, for example, pacing is definitely linked to the exercise outcome, and that time in the brain is not measured as a absolute, so 30 seconds, 10 seconds, but as the time period between experiences. So it's a relative measure. And then the last question, can an opponent provide a distraction, taking us out of that associated state and reducing time distortion? Well, you can see in the top figure, we couldn't find any differences during the trial between the conditions with or without an opponent. And throughout the trial, so in the three different time points, there was also no difference. So it would seem that an opponent can provide distraction and therefore reduce time distortion. However, we should say that we tested novice cyclists, so they have no real experience with this kind of time trial. And we know from literature that novices base their exercise behavior mainly on their internal sensations of pain and discomfort, whereas experienced athletes seem to be used to this associated state of pain and discomfort and are able to use external factors such as opponents, teammates, and the environment a lot better to impact their exercise behavior. So concluding, the passing of time is perceived to slow down during exercise due to a more densely packed packing of experiences, and this reduces returns to pre-exercise level after a short recovery period. The impact of exercise intensity on time perception might be restricted to time perception tasks linked to the exercise outcome and also relative tasks, not absolute. And the collection of time of novice exercises was not affected by the introduction of opponents. And this is possibly because they are very based their exercise behavior a lot on internal sensations and not so much on external sensations. So it would be interesting to do some further testing with relative measures and with experience exercise. Well, that's perfect because I just have the practical application to do. Seeing as there's a difference between chronological time and what we experience as time during exercise, it would be good to educate people on this difference so that they kind of take that into account when playing pacing strategy, for example, or when they are doing something like running up ski slope. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you want to know a little bit more about time perception, there's a talk on Friday, 8 o'clock, with Andrew Edwards in there, and he's talking a little bit more about time perception. So check out that as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Stein, for an interesting presentation. And now the session is open for discussion, and I would like to start out with a question. Maybe I missed it in your presentation, but the participants you had in the in this study, can you just? I don't think you did. You have so much on them, and you said they were healthy. But could you just elaborate on what state of physical activity level or and so what were they? Could you just and maybe also elaborate how much of impact that could have on your data, because you said there was a lot of variation. Stein, can you hear me?
Sorry, I couldn't hear anything of the question. Sorry.
Shall I repeat my question? Stein?
Yes.
Yeah. So I want to say that I could not, as far as I saw in your presentation, I could not see the profile so much of your participants. What you said they were healthy, and what kind of state of physical activity they were in, and so could you just elaborate on what that could have had of impact on your data, because you said there was a lot of variation in your data.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So these were all university students or staff, so these were all definitely just active people that like exercise 2 to 3 times mm-hmm. a week in a variety of sports, but were not experienced in cycling per se. I think the most experience in cycling was cycling to work now and then. Mm-hmm. then as for the variation, I think what we saw is that some people thought said stop after 15 seconds instead of 30, mm-hmm. and some said stop after 45 to 50 seconds. So there was mm-hmm. quite a high variation in that.
Yeah.
And that might be due to the task itself. So mm-hmm. 30 seconds as an absolute measure. Mm-hmm. So what we could have done, for example, what you see in other research is say, they asked people to say stop, for example, after 50, they thought 50% of the task was done. Mm-hmm. Or 75% of the task was done. Mm-hmm. And you relate the perception of time to the exercise itself. And they saw a little bit better, a little bit less variation. So we could do, if we do it again, we might do something like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that has to do with the fact that time doesn't seem to be measured absolutely. So we humans seem to be very bad at saying 30 seconds, but we are very good at going from one experience to the other.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay, so just to be clear on my question, so the impact, for example, on the physical activity background of these people, does that impact the perception of time? If, for example, if you're in good shape, so to speak, would that have an impact on your data, or if you are overweighted or something? I mean, could that, is that something that that is somehow inferential on data?
Yeah, I can't say anything about overweight. But I do know that, for example, very experienced athletes, they are better at pacing themselves. So I would also think that maybe they are more used to this associative state of pain and discomfort, which mm-hmm. maybe the effect of the time distortion might be less for them. So they might be better at perceiving time and dealing with that overload of sensory cues during exercise. So I think there's definitely a difference between office exercises and people that cycle every day, for example, and are used to this kind of pain.
Yeah,
definitely.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so do you any other, Hans Christa, do you have any questions to add on? You had to unmute Hans Christa.
Thank you for a nice presentation. Mm. The first question, the number of subjects in the abstract is 13, and in your presentation are counted to 12 plus 9, 21. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
So you have changed the number of subjects from the abstract to the presentation.
Yeah, that's true. The abstract was written when we had 13 participants. We hoped to be at the full number when we wrote the abstract, but yeah, just to practical reasons, we didn't. Although there was no real change in the findings with adding more participants, because this is an ongoing study.
Yeah,
that's why it's a different number.
Yeah, and then you talk about time is perceived to move slower during exercise, but why? What are your explanation, or what could be the mechanism, if it's so? What could be the mechanisms behind?
So it's perceived time. What we think is a mechanism is that time seems to be measured in our brain from experience to experience and not from second to second. And if we're exercising, you get an overload of sensory information. So you get a lot of exercise experiences very closely put together, which makes time slower.
Good. All right. So now we
Was it time? Do we have a time for another question or?
No, that would be a very, very short one.
Okay.
In this sense, yeah.
Yeah.
Just to be fair to the other.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So I think we have to finish up on this part and go on with the next speaker. And the next speaker here is Guy Mata from the UK. Guy itself is from Brazil. And he would present a study with the title Pacing and Performance During the World 24-Hour Mountain Bike Championship. Please, Guy.
Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so yeah, good afternoon. Thank you for the introduction. And yeah, as my name is Guy, I am a PhD student at the Canterbury Christchurch University. And I will present here a parallel study that we developed about pacing and performance during the World 24-Hour Mountain Bike Championships. So as you know, mountain biking is a very popular outdoor activity, and it is also included in the Olympics. So it's a very famous sport, and it is characterized mainly by a massive start competition. So the athletes start all together during the race, and in which the cyclists, they have to perform several laps in an off-road circuit involving trails, hills, and technical terrains. Or like the picture there, you can see some obstacles that they built in the course. But on the other hand, 24-hour mountain bike races are also very popular, attracting professional elite riders, non-elite riders, amateur, but it is not included in the Olympic Games. And contrary to road cycling and more other Olympic sports, this modality has received little attention from the scientific point of view. One factor that has been regarded as really important underpinning endurance performance is the pacing strategy, which has been defined previously as the goal-directed distribution and management of effort across the duration of an exercise bout. There are some studies investigating the pacing across different cycling disciplines, but there are actually the literature lacks studies investigating the pacing adopted by cyclists during ultra endurance cycling races like the 24-hour mountain bike races. So the purpose of this study was to investigate the impact of sex, performance level, and different additions on pacing and performance during the World 24-hour Mountain Bike Championships. And to do so, we collected data from 837 men and 157 women who participated in 8 editions of this race from 2012 to 2019. And all of this data was extracted from the official race website. So it is publicly available if you want to look at it. It's available on that link over there. And in this race, the cyclists, they have to complete the highest number of laps they can in 24 hours. And in the table here, you can see the characteristics of each of the races that we analyzed, comprising the number of participants in each race, the course distance of each race, and also the distance covered in each edition of the race. So you can see that there is a high variation in the course distance in the environmental conditions, like racing in Brazil, which is pretty warm, and racing Scotland, which would be really rainy and muddy. So there is quite variation in the conditions of each of the races. And to exclude some cyclists that did not complete the race or even didn't aim to finish the race. So some cyclists, for example, could decide to do only 12 hours of the race as a training or something like that. So to exclude this kind of athletes in the database, we included only cyclists covering more than 2 times the standard deviation of the mean distance from each edition of the race, and also completed each race in at least 19.2 hours, corresponding to 80% of the time. We split the sample between men and women. We also split them in 5 performance groups according to the distance covered. So the first group was composed by the fastest athletes, and the fifth group was composed by the slowest athletes, each group with 199 athletes, and the last group with 198 athletes. We also split the races in different editions, as I said previously, to analyze the differences in pacing. So as the statistical analysis, we compared the differences between men and women on overall performance by performing an independent sample t-tests. We also normalized the absolute speed of each lap to the mean race speed. So we analyzed the changes in speed in percentage values. And to analyze the pacing, we analyzed the behavior of pacing by comparing the normalized speed of each cyclist during the first lap, the middle lap, and the last lap. And we performed one-way and repeated measures all over to compare the differences, the decrease in the changes in speed. We assessed the differences between sexes, editions, and performance group through two-way repeated measure ANOVAs, and we also performed Pearson correlations to calculate the association between the speed, the normalized speed during the first lap, and the total distance covered. So overall, our results showed that the athletes covered 276 kilometers in an average time of 23.7 hours. But men and women covered 278 kilometers and 262 kilometers, respectively. And that's a significant difference of around 6%. Regarding pacing, we found a decrease in the normalized speed from the first lap throughout the races. So characterized by a positive pacing, in which the athletes started at a really high speed, high pace at the beginning of the race, but decreased the speed as the race progressed. We also find, as expected, significant interactions between the pacing and the different editions, because each race had different environments, different weather conditions, different race profiles, including uphills, downhill sessions. So there were differences between races, and these differences was probably dictated by the differences in the course profile. We did not perform any analysis about variance, but it seems that the first lap was the one with the highest variance between the other laps, so mainly the start of the race. We also found significant interactions between the pacing and performance groups. So as you can see in the graph represented by the red line, the fastest athletes, they adopted a lower normalized running speed and decreased the speed less in the end of the race. So they adopted a higher normalized speed at the last lap in comparison to the slower athletes. We found no significant interactions between pacing and sex. So despite of the differences in performance, a 6% difference in the distance covered, the men and women roughly adopted the same profile, the same pacing strategy. The Pearson correlations showed an inverse moderate association between the normalized speed during the first lap and the total distance covered, suggesting that the athletes who covered the longest distance were those who also started at a lower normalized speed than the others. So in summary, we found that the cyclists adopt a positive pacing strategy, so decreasing the speed from the first lap onwards during the 24-hour mountain bike races we analyzed. But we also found distinct strategies in each race, which is probably dictated by the course profile, the environmental profile, weather, hills, and among other factors. Men and women, they display similar pacing strategies, even though the performance was 6% higher for the men. We also found that fastest athletes adopt a lower normalized speed and a less pronounced decrease in the last lap.
1 minute.
Together with the Pearson correlations, our results suggest that the athletes should adopt a conservative strategy during the early stages of a 24-hour mountain bike race to improve overall performance. I'd like to thank you for your time. Thanks my supervisors for the support, and now I'm open to the questions.
Thank you very much, Guy, for an interesting presentation. And now the session is open for discussion. I would like to start out again and ask you. I'm not sure I saw the age of these participants. Did you mention or did you show the data of the age of the participants?
No, not really. Not the exact age. We had their age groups, but we didn't have access to exactly their age. But we found some differences between ages, but because of some co-founding factors, we decided not to include it in the presentation. So we just have the age groups and not exactly the characteristics of the participants itself.
Yeah, okay. Just that you, I think in the abstract you said that there was no differences between women and men, and I was just thinking, well, what about the age of the between these two groups? Would that have an impact on the speed and so on?
Mm. Yeah, between the age groups, we actually found some very minor differences in the middle lap. So actually, I don't think that the age would be a big factor for this kind of pacing.
Okay, thank you. Hans Christa, do you have any questions?
This is a tough race. Have you tried it yourself?
No, I never tried. I wish I could.
So I have some questions. You talk about that you're surprised a little bit, that the better have a lower initial speed, a less pronounced decrease in speed. Mm-hmm. But are you surprised to that?
No, not really, because we have some. It is very new because we don't have any data on ultra endurance cycling about pacing, and that there is a lot more things about running and ultra marathon races. And it usually we actually can see the same pattern between ultra marathons and cycling races. In these kind of cycling races, that the best athletes, they tend to start at a lower intensity, a lower normalized intensity, and decrease less. So we say that they adopted a more even pacing, even though the profile in general is a positive strategy.
So that's an observation. So what is your explanation to that? Why can you see this pattern?
Well, I think that mainly this has to be linked with experience. So these athletes must know how to better distribute their energy during a race. They know that it's some long hours, including a lot of hills and some muddy sections, some technical sessions. So I think it's linked mainly to the experience, and they know that they should take it slow at the beginning, but try to decrease the speed less. Just to avoid overexertion.
Can you also identify other factors? Experience is one, but if you explore it a little bit, do you have other factors that can influence the strategy?
Well, if you take into account the profile of the race, so maybe if the athletes have a big hill at the start of the course, maybe they would decide to adopt a slower pace at the beginning because they have to go through that same hill over and over and over during 24 hours. So I think the course as well.
And how popular is it to have individual race and race as a team in this sport? So was this only individual values on 24 hours, or was it also?
Yeah, this one, yes, that we didn't. I think there were some teams, but we did not analyze the teams, just the individual athlete. Originally, this race was started as a team sport, as a team race, but now they have this individual race. So most of the athletes, all of the athletes in our sample were competing individually.
Did you find something else when you compare sexes, different gender, say men and women?
We have one minute left.
We tried to compare the top 10 men and the top 10 women to see if there were differences. The pacing was the same, did not change between men and women in the top 10. So the top 10 athletes were not different in pacing, but the difference in performance increased. It was almost very call 20% difference in the distance covered. So the the difference in performance increased, but the pacing again was the same.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone, and thank you, Guy. That was really interesting and session and a lot of good discussion points, I think. I think with this, I could say thank you again, and I think we can close this session for now. So thank you.